السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن شاء الله we begin our reading from صحيح البخاري in the book of jihad. The sector called the horses are for three. Narrated Abu Huraira, Allah's Apostle said, صلى الله عليه وسلم, horses are kept for one of three purposes. For some people they are a source of reward, for some others they are a means of shelter, and for some others they are a source of sins. The one for whom they are a source of reward is he who keeps a horse for Allah's cause, such as jihad, tying it with a long tether on a meadow or in a garden, with the result that whatever it eats from the area of the meadow or the garden where it is tied will be counted as good deeds for his benefit. And if it should break its rope and jump over one or two hillocks, then all its dung and its foot marks will be written as good deeds for him. And if it passes by a river and drinks water from it, even though he had no intention of watering it, even then he will get the reward for its drinking. As for the man for whom horses are a source of sins, he is the one who keeps a horse for the sake of pride and pretense and showing enmity for Muslims. Such a horse will be a source of sins for him. When Allah's Apostle was asked about donkeys, he replied, "Nothing has been revealed to me about them except this unique, comprehensive verse." In Surah Al-Zalzalah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Then anyone who does an atom's or a small ant's weight of a good shall see it, and anyone who does an atom's or a small ant's weight of evil shall see it." This great hadith that Al-Imam Al-Bukhari narrated is considered to be a long hadith, and inshallah we'll discuss it, we'll discuss all of it to bring out the benefits from it. First off, we notice the fiqh and the knowledge of Imam Al-Bukhari. He mentioned three sectors about horses and jihad. The first sector, or the first hadith that he mentioned, was mentioning horses and their usefulness and the good about horses, of course, in jihad and in general. And then he said, or he mentioned a hadith that we mentioned before. For example, one of the hadith that we mentioned before, for example, Allah's Apostle said, if there is any evil omen in anything, then it is in the woman, the horse, and the house, and so forth. Any other hadith that we mentioned in the past lesson. So first he mentioned horses with something good, then he mentioned horses with something bad. Then in this hadith, he showed which is good and which is bad. In this particular hadith, he said horses are kept for one of three purposes. For some people, they are a source of reward. For others, they are a means of shelter. And for some others, they are a source of sins. Here he said three types. Although Imam Bukhari in his narration, he only mentioned the two types. The one type, the one who gets a reward, and the other type is the one who gets a sin for his bad usage of this horse, of this benefit that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him. So we can see how Imam al-Bukhari can actually did not mention the third one, which is shelter, using a horse for other means. And this was mentioned in the Quran. You know, you don't only use horses for jihad, you use it for other means, for, you know, as a ride or even for food. And it was narrated that Asma, radiallahu anha, they had a horse and it was slaughtered, and back then they did eat horse meat, and it was eaten, and of course the Prophet was gifted from it. So ayahs in the Quran mention that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created horses not only for to be a ride, not only for jihad, not only for food. It has many uses that the human being can use. So in this hadith, al-Bukhari only mentioned the two things. He didn't mention about the third part where the horses can have other things besides jihad. Why? Because this book is the book of jihad. So he only mentions the things that has to do with jihad. We said such as the good And the bad, of how somebody can use a horse for enmity, showing enmity for Muslims, or a sake of honor, and so forth. So this hadith, he did not mention that part, and the part that we said some people use horses as shelter or so forth, because it was out of context. And this is from the knowledge of Bukhari. This hadith, as we said, is connected to jihad because horses either use it for jihad or you own it waiting for jihad. And inshallah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this sheikh will continue and explain the hadith. Assalamu alaikum. Inshallah, we mentioned the long narration that was mentioned of this hadith, although it was mentioned in Sahih Muslim. It was mentioned in Sahih Muslim. This narration, it says in Sahih Muslim that reported Allah's Messenger, may peace be upon him, as saying, if owner, if any owner of gold or silver does not pay what is due on him, when the day of resurrection would come, plates of fire would be beaten out for him. This would then be heated in the fire of hell on his sides. His forehead and his back would be kosherized with them. Whenever these cool down, the process is repeated during the day, and the extent of which would be 50,000 years, until judgment is pronounced among servants, and he sees whether his path is to take him to paradise or to hell. It was said, Messenger of Allah, what about the camel? He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said, if any owner of the camel does not pay what is due on him, and of his due in that camel is also to milk it on the day when it comes down to water, when the day of resurrection comes, a soft sandy plain will be set for him, as extensive as possible. He will find that not a single young one is missing, and they will trample him with their hoofs and bite him with their mouths. As often as the first of them passes him, the last of them would be made to return during a day, the extent of which would be 50,000 years, until judgment is pronounced among servants, and he sees whether his path is to take him to paradise or to hell. It was again said, Messenger of Allah, what about the cows, the cattle, and sheep? He said, if any owner of the cattle and sheep does not pay what is due on them, when the day of resurrection comes, a soft sandy plain will be spread for them. They will find none of them missing, with twisted horns, without horns, or with a broken horn. And they will gore him with their horns and trample him with their hoofs. As often as the first of them passes him, the last of them would be made to return to him during a day, the extent of which would be 50,000 years. Until judgment would be pronounced among the servants, and he would be shown his path leading him to paradise or to hell. It was said, Messenger of Allah, what about the horse? Upon this he said, the horses are three types. To one that these are a burden, and to another man these are a covering, and still to another man these are the source of a reward. The one for whom these are a burden is a person who rears them in order to show off for vainglory or for opposing the Muslims, and for opposing the Muslims, so they are a burden for him. The one for whom these are covering is a person who rears them for the sake of Allah, but does not forget the right of Allah concerning their backs and their necks. And so they are a covering for him. As for those which bring reward, these are the persons who rears them for the sake of Allah to be used for Muslims, and he puts them in the meadow and the field. And whatever thing do these eat from, the meadow and field will be recorded as on his behalf as good deeds, as would also the amount of their dung and urine. And these would not break their halter and plant the course, or two without having got recorded the amount of their hoof marks and their dung as a good deed on his behalf. pretty much the Prophet is saying that every movement, or whenever they eat or they do anything from the benefit of their owner, this is counted as a good deed for the owner. He continued and says, and their master does not bring them past a river from which they drink, though he did not intend to quench their thirst, but Allah would record for him the amount of what they drink on his behalf as deeds. It was said, Messenger of Allah, what about the donkeys? Upon this, he said, nothing has been revealed to me in regard to donkeys in particular, except this one verse of a comprehensive nature. He who does an atom's weight of good will see it, and he who does an atom's weight of evil will see it. That was the narration of Imam Muslim. It's a longer narration, and it has some additions than the narration that was mentioned in Bukhari. Jazakumullah khairan, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a'la wa a'lam. We continue the explanation of the hadith from Sahih al-Bukhari now. We say that the Prophet ﷺ said horses are kept for one of three purposes. For some people, they are a source of reward. For some others, they are a means of shelter. And for some others, they are a source of sins. The one for whom they are a source of reward is he who keeps a horse for Allah's cause, such as jihad. Tying it with a long tether, with a long rope, or a long, you can call it a rope, I guess, on a meadow or in a garden, with the result that whatever it eats from the area of the meadow or the garden, whether it is tied, where it is tied, will be counted as good deeds for his benefit, and proven its tongue and its footmarks and its urine, everything that it does, that he's taking care of this animal, for this horse, is counted as a good deed. Since he's taking care of this animal for the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, everything that it does, that he's taking care of, you know, he's supplying the food, he's, you know, bringing it in his meadow or his garden. So everything that it does, and it's for the cause of Allah, everything, every little small, even the footmarks of this animal, is considered to be a good deed for the owner of this animal. Okay? And then he mentions, although in another place in his book, he mentions, or Bukhari narrates the full narration. We said this narration, he brought in the context that has to do with jihad. In other narrations, he brought in the full context because it had to do with the sector that he is talking about. So, for example, you'll find that there is a sector in one of the books of Bukhari. He said it's called "People's Drink and Animals from Rivers." In this, he mentions the full narration. And then he comes to the part where you said that he did not mention in the narration of jihad, which is about the person who owns a horse and there is sort of a shelter for them. And he said that whom who own a horse for a shelter or for any other cause, and he does not violate. He does not violate its right as an animal. For example, he treats it well, he feeds it, he drinks it, and so forth. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that this animal, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, still may give him the good deeds for it. Still may give him the good deeds for it. So he had pretty much three types. One type is the one that brought this animal, saying, this is for jihad, this is for this cause. I'll feed it, I'll make it drink, I'll supply everything for this animal for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another one is like, you know, you're going out, you're buying a car because you need it. So somebody who needs a horse is actually buying it for his own needs. and he treats it well, then he takes much of good deeds for what he has done for this animal and taken care of. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives him the benefit that he paid for as buying the animal and so forth. And then was the third one, which is mentioned in the narration, in both narrations of course, the one who won't get the reward except he'll get a sin because he used it for pride, used it for pretense, used it for showing off, for showing enmity and opposition for Muslims. Such horse would be a source of sins for the owner of it. And inshallah subhanahu wa ta'ala in explaining the hadith.
Assalamu alaikum. Inshallah we'll start explaining the hadith with its long narration, because it has a lot of good information in it, and inshallah subhanahu wa ta'ala it will be it's a good information for a Muslim to gain. So I'll start with this explanation. And in the long narration, which is a Sahih Muslim, the Prophet he says, if any owner of gold or silver does not pay what is due on him, when the day of resurrection would come, plates of fire would be beaten out for him. Before I continue on reading, I just want to point out, we are mentioning this even though it has nothing to do directly with jihad, although we find good information in this hadith. That's why the Sheikh went into this explaining the full hadith, so we can get the full information out of it and the full benefit out of it. So we say, if any owner of gold or silver does not pay what is due on him, when the day of resurrection would come, plates of fire would be beaten out for him. These would be then be heated in the fire of hell, and his sides, his forehead, and his back would be kosherized with them. Whenever these cool down, the process is repeated during a day, the extent of which would be 50,000 years. Here we say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah At-Tawbah, one day when heat will be produced out of that wealth in the fire of hell, and with it will be branded their foreheads, their flanks, and their backs. This is the treasure which you buried for yourselves. You taste it, then the treasures you buried. So, this hadith, or this beginning, talks about those who does not pay zakah, those who have gold or silver and hold zakah, hold from paying zakah, hold themselves from paying zakah, for any reason, or for the reason, for a specific reason, which this hadith is talking about, is for those who are wealthy and they like wealth and they're not generous. They love money. They're money lovers, as some people may know this phrase, and they want to keep it. They want to keep it for themselves. They don't want to give anybody else from their money. So the Prophet and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran and the Prophet in this hadith mentions what they will get. Also, this hadith is that the day of resurrection, the day of judgment, will be 50,000 years. You know that the days of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one day of them is about 50,000 years of what we count. So the day of judgment, the first day, the first 50,000 years will be hell. And then the process is repeated during a day, during the rest of their punishment, if they continue to be in there. You know, it depends of how bad they did. The final judgment is pronounced among servants, and he sees whether his path is to take him to paradise or to hell. Now, we say that this hadith is a proof that who does not perform zakat, who does not pay zakat, and he's a Muslim, he may still go to heaven after being punished for doing zakah. So he's not a kafir, unless he does not believe in zakah. Unless he comes and say, okay, I am a Muslim, but I don't believe in zakah. Zakah is not something that I believe in. Then this is a separate ruling. It can reach kufr, can reach disbelief. Although, here is someone who has done it for a desire.
who did not pay for a personal desire. Not he says that there is a debt, but he's, you know, we do mistakes. So for his personal desires, he did not pay. He did not pay zakat. So he may go after, and he may stay for more punishment. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala judges on this point. Then the Sahaba here asked the Prophet والسلام, of other materials, other wealth materials. You know, when you talk about I'm wealthy, is it just money? No, it's you know, what houses you own, what kind of car you own, what clothes you own, and so forth. So here they're asking about things that a person, if you own it or own a certain amount of it, you should pay zakat on it. So it was said, Messenger of Allah, what about the camel? So he replied to Allah Sallam, if any owner of the camel does not pay what is due on him, and who is due in that camel is also to milk it in the day when it comes down to water. When the day of the resurrection comes, now here he says, but whom owns wealthy, such, you know, he's wealthy because he owns camels. It begged them, if you own a certain amount of camels, you know, you're considered to be a millionaire. So say, for example, you own a certain amount of camels and you did not pay the car that was due on you. So in the day of resurrection comes a so expensive plane, it will be set for him as expensive as possible. He will find that not a single young one is missing. What will happen is Allah will bring those animals or that wealth that he owned. We're talking now for this example in this hadith, camels. Those camels will be brought to him, will be brought in the day of judgment. And they'll trample him with their hoofs and bite him with their mouth. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will use these animals that he did not pay zakat for to punish him. And then he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as often as him, the last of them would be made to return during a day, the extent of which would be 50,000 years. Until judgment is pronounced once again among servants, and he sees whether, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will judge whether his path is to take him to paradise or to hell. Then he was asked also about cattle, sheep. If he does not pay what is due on them, you know, an owner who does not pay what is due on them, when the day of resurrection comes, a soft sandy plain will be spread for them. You will find none of them missing. If you own 500 cows, none of them will be missing. None of them. If you own 500 sheep, none of them will be missing. In this case, he says, you will find none of them missing, with twisted horns, without horns, or with a broken horn. Meaning that you will find them perfectly. You're not going to find a sheep with a broken horn. You're not going to find a sheep with a twisted horn. Every single one will be there perfectly. And they will gore him with their horns and trample him with their hoofs. As often as the first of them passes him, the last of them would be made to return him to you during a day of the extent of which would be 50,000 years, until judgment will be pronounced among servants, and so on. Then he was asked about the horses, but this is a separate matter here. Why? Because the horses, if you own horses, it's not considered to be wealth. Camel, cattle, sheep are considered to be wealth that you pay the cat for. Horses were not considered so. So when he was asked about them, his answer was different. So he said, peace be upon him, the horses are of three types. Then he mentions the three types. The first of them, as for those which bring reward to the person who rears them for the sake of Allah, to be used for Muslims, for example, jihad, and he puts them in the meadow and field, or a field. Whatever thing do these eat from? For example, every single time they eat, every single leaf that they eat, it's considered a good deed for him. Even the urine and their dung is considered to be a good deed. And it was mentioned in the hadith in the narration of Bukhari that those animals that, subhanAllah, he tied them with a long rope. And this is how Muslims treat animals. You don't treat them in a bad way. Long rope, so they can feel more freedom to walk around where they are kept. So those bring good deeds for the owner. And even if their master brings them to a river with no intention to make them drink from it, and they accidentally drink from it, for every single drink they take, it is recorded for him the amount of what they drink on his behalf as good deeds. So this shows us of how when a person buys something for jihad, a right for jihad, and he owns it, he keeps it, he feeds it, he takes care of it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives him a good reward, better and higher rank of what he did for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the first kind. The second kind is the one who doesn't get a sin and doesn't get a deed. The one for whom these are a covering is the person who rears them for the sake of Allah, but does not forget the right of Allah concerning the backs and their necks, and so they are covering them. Pretty much, if the one who needs a horse, you just bought a horse. Not for intention for the sake of Allah. But what if for a certain reason, you know, he bought a horse because he needs. Later on, he said, oh, I'll use this horse for this certain matter or for this certain event for the sake of Allah. Then he'll get good deeds on the amount that he used this horse for the sake of Allah. And the rest of his usage of this horse, of this animal, he won't get any sins or rewards. And of course, as long as he does not forget the right of Allah concerning their backs and their necks. The last kind, it was said the Messenger of Allah, the person who rears them in the order to show off, the order to oppose Muslims, to plan things against Muslims, to show enmity against Muslims, for glory and so forth. All these things, they're supposed to be a burden over for him, supposed to be sins. This is here the evil omen. The other, the one who gets reward, this is a good horse. This is a good usage. So pretty much Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, or the Prophet is telling us, however we use this animal, if we use it for the sake of Allah, we get good deeds. If we use it for a bad cause, then you'll get sins. You're sinful. So, and this is with many things. If you use a car to go to a bar, then the usage of the car is bad. It's an evil omen. But if you use the car to go to a masjid to pray, then this is a good deed. Finally, he was asked about the donkeys. And he said, nothing has been revealed to me in regards of the donkeys, in particular, except this one verse of a comprehensive nature. The Prophet, he used this general meaning of this ayah. It contains everything. It can be used to prove of anything. You know, the ayah talks about whoever does good, he will be rewarded good. And whoever does bad, he will be rewarded bad. It's fair. And the ayah says, he who does an atom's weight of good will see it. And he who does an atom's weight of evil will see it. And this was the explanation that the Shaykh has mentioned. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. The Shaykh brings here a very good point about this hadith. And this point is about al-qiyas. Al-qiyas is a method that some scholars use in preceding a certain fatwa or certain ruling. And what they do is they take a certain, if they find a matter that there is no ruling before, or there's no specific text that they can use as a proof, then they take a similar incident and they judge the incident they want to rule on that previous incident. Okay? So, some scholars said in this hadith, when the Prophet was asked about the donkeys, and he said, nothing has been revealed to me in regard of the donkeys, except this one verse of a comprehensive nature. And he said, he who does an atoms of goodwill seed, and he who does an atoms weight of evil. I'm sorry, we'll see it. This is clear. All right. So whoever will use donkeys for good will get good, and otherwise, you know, if you use it for bad, you get bad. So the scholars broke down into three schools. A school said, no, there's no such thing as kliyas at all. Another school said, there is kliyas. And there's another school, which is in the middle, which is what the Sheikh recommends, is go in the middle. They say, we only use it if it is greatly needed. Such method only gets used if it's greatly needed. To judge a certain matter on a previous matter that is similar to it. And according to that ruling, you rule the matter that you're trying to figure out to go for. Is it halal, haram, and so forth? You know, is it forbidden or is it not? So, we say here that those who said, qiyas is good for all, said that the Prophet ﷺ used this ayah. He had nothing has been revealed to him, so he used this ayah. But those who says no, they say because you misunderstood the usage of the Prophet ﷺ, the usage of this ayah by the Prophet ﷺ. When we find something, has nothing been revealed about it, we take the ayahs that have the general meanings, that so many matters can fall under it. And through the general rulings, we can find other specific rulings. And we don't go to other matters, and through that we find our proofs. We find the proofs from the Quran. And they use the same hadith as a proof. So those who say it's qiyas use this hadith, and other proofs, of course. And also those who say no to qiyas use this part of the hadith. And the others, as we said, say we only use it if it's greatly needed. And from this hadith, it seems that those who say no to qiyas are the ones who are right in their proof. Because if the Prophet said qiyas, he could have said, nothing has been revealed to me in the regard of the donkeys. I think maybe it's the same ruling as the horses. He can say that. He didn't look to the horses, or to the cattle, or to the sheep, or whatever. But when he used something that hasn't been revealed to him in regard to the donkeys, he took it and judged on it through a general ayah that anything would fall under it. So it seems that those who said no to qiyas were better in using this proof, that their proof was much stronger. Although we say that the middle school says, yes, we don't use qiyas all the time, we only use it if it's greatly, greatly needed. And this is what the Sheikh has said, and subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. We go into the next hadith of our lesson today, which is another sector from al-Bukhari. In this hadith, in which is the narration narrated Muslim from Abu Uqayl, from Abu al-Mutawakkil al-Naji, I called on Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari and said to him, relate to me what you have heard from Allah's apostle, he said. I accompanied him on one of the journeys, he replied, Abu Uqayl. Let me say that again. I called in Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari and said to him, relate to me what you have heard from Allah's apostle. He said, that's Abu Mutakil al-Najm. So I accompanied him. I accompanied him on one of the journeys, and Abu Uqayl said, I don't know whether that journeys was for the purpose of jihad or umrah. When we were returning, Jabir continued, the Prophet said, whoever wants to return earlier to his family should hurry up. We set off, and I was on a black, red, tainted camel, having no defect, and other and people were behind me. While I was in the state, in that state, the camel stopped suddenly because it was exhausted. On that, the Prophet said to me, oh, Jabir, wait. Then he hit it once with his lash and it started moving fast pace. He said, will you sell that camel? Will you sell the camel? I replied in affirmative when we reached Medina, and the Prophet went to the mosque along with his companions. I too went to him after tying the camel on a pavement at the mosque gate. Then I said to him, this is your camel. He came out and started examining the camel and saying, this camel is ours. Then the Prophet sent some awaq, which is an amount of gold, saying, give it to Jabir. Then he asked, have you taken the full price of the camel? I replied in affirmative. He said, both the price and the camel are for you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Explaining this hadith, which is from Abu Aqil, from Al-Mutawakkil Al-Naji, I called on Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari, said to him, relate to me what you have heard from Allah's Apostle. Jabir said, I accompanied him in one of the journeys. And then Abu Aqil said, I did not know whether the journey was for the purpose of jihad or umrah. And what appears to be that it was jihad and it was the battle of Tabuk. Jabir kept saying, when they were returning from Tabuk, as we have mentioned, the Prophet said, whoever wants to return earlier to his family should hurry up. What happened, the Prophet sensed that some companions are very tired after a battle. They went back to their family as soon as possible. So he sensed that, and he's very merciful. So he said, whoever wants to return to his family, he should hurry up. So Jabir said, we set off, and I was on a black, red-tainted camel, having no defect, and the people were behind me. So Jabir was running with this camel. While I was in that state, the camel stopped suddenly. The camel got sick, got exhausted, it was tired, it was running, so, you know, he started stopping. And the Prophet, because he loves his companions, he used to check them out, how are they doing, you know? Everything's all right. How this journey is going on? Anything? Anybody needs anything? Are you okay? Is your camel okay? Do you need any water? Do you need any food? So he saw that Jabir is starting to stop. So he went to see what's going on, and he found that Jabir, this camel got exhausted. So he said, Jabir, wait. Oh, Jabir, wait. And when you see in the other translations, it's also Jabir, hold on. Why? Because the Prophet hit it once, the camel with his lash. And here, it is permissible that you would hit an animal, such as a camel or a horse, that is, you know, not an animal like a dog, but an animal like a horse or a camel, to start moving. Not a harsh hitting, but sort of a hard tapping. Just to let this animal know, you know, you need to hurry up. I need, you know, I need to get going. So, the Prophet ﷺ, when he hit it once, it started moving on a fast pace. And that's because of the blessings of the Prophet ﷺ. He then asked Jabir, will you sell the camel? So, Jabir replied in the affirmative. He said, sure, when we reach Medina. And this is a proof of something that some of the scholars had different opinions about, which is selling on a condition. Although in this condition it is permissible to say, oh, you know, sure, I'll sell you this when we reach that place, on a certain condition. And the Prophet went to the mosque, and this is from the Sunnah, that when he comes back from a travel or a journey, I'm sorry, he goes to a mosque, to his mosque, along with his companions, to meet everyone, to greet, hey, I'm back, and to find everyone, the place in the community. So, Jabir says, I too went to him after tying the camel on the pavement at the mosque gate. So he tied the camel on the mosque gate. Step by, comes in, and he sacrifices to Islam. This is your camel. He receives the camel that he wanted to buy. And he discussed, a price and everything. And the Prophet ﷺ came out, examined the camel, make sure, oh, this is the camel I was going to buy. And he said, the camel is ours, it's mine now. And he gave you the amount of gold that, or the amount of money that they agreed upon. And told his companion, or another companion, give it to Jabir, or he gave it to Jabir. Then he asked, have you taken the full price of the camel? So Jabir said, yes. Are you satisfied? Are you satisfied? Do you want more? Is that okay? Is that enough? Jabir said, yeah, sure. That's enough for me. And here, there's some very nice scripture from the Prophet. The Prophet and other narrations, it was mentioned that Jabir was in a serious, bad economical position, financially. He had no money. He was gone poor. And this guy is going out with the camel to fight while he has no money. He comes back, he got no money. So the Prophet says, how can I help this guy? All right, we'll set this up so that I can buy his camel, I'll give him some money, and then when he goes back to his house, I'll send him the camel back. So what happens, that he sends the camel back saying, both the price and the camel are for you. And it's a very gesture of how the Prophet ﷺ takes care of his companions. How he has a passion and how he has a spirit of helping them out without making them feel bad. If you find a friend that is in a bad situation, you just don't go, oh, here's some money. I'm wealthy, here's some money. No. You can do a nice gesture so that he won't feel, not insulted, but you don't want to get offended by saying, oh, you're poor and I'm wealthy. So the Prophet ﷺ uses this very nice gesture to help out Jabir with his financial situation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best.
This hadith also has a benefit or a lesson to teach about jihad. This lesson is that there always should be some sort of networking, communication, collaboration, helping each other between the mujahideen. The Prophet, example, not only for a leader who helps out his companions and helps out his soldiers, but he's also an example for other soldiers. If a mujahid, I think other mujahid needs some help, I assist him. I give him my hand. Do you need any help? Even if I'm away, even if I don't make jihad, I don't engage in jihad right now, I'm getting away. Oh, can I help with some money? Can help, is there any means that I can help you guys? So the Muslim is always helping his brother. If his brother, and that's of course, and do something good, don't see your brother stealing and say, oh, I'm going to steal with him because I have to help my brother. No. We're talking now about jihad. He's going up for jihad, so the Muslims help each other out. That's one thing. The other thing is, to talk about this, is that the fact that when you look how the Prophet helped out Jabir by a hit. What do you mean by a hit? By a hit of a horse. He just hit the camel once. And this hit of the camel was considered to be some sort of helping out. So imagine how many good deeds you may get if you actually, help train a mujahid or, fund a mujahideen or give them any logistic or financial, any sort of support. So imagine and think about how many good deeds you get If only just one hit, you'll get something. You're helping your brother out. So imagine, the more effort you make, the more good deeds you get, and the more it doubles up. This is the end of our lesson today. Inshallah, if any of you have any questions, then go ahead. Of course, as you know, our program is a lesson, and then questions about the lesson. And after the questions about the lesson, and then we will start general session of questions and answers. إن شاء الله شيخ طرهاني أنا ترجمت هذه المسألة. الأخ أم مجاهد كانت أرسلت لي سؤال وأنا أتحدث عن مسألة معينة، فيعني لعلها تأخذ دور متقدم. هي أرسلت لي في البرايفت، سوف أترجم إن شاء الله السؤال، فلعلها تأخذ دور متقدم. لا أعرف إذا كانت هي موجودة معنا الآن أم لا، ولكن كانت سؤال في عن أحد الأسئلة، وهو عن من لا يدفع الزكاة، وسألت عن يعني نحن قلنا عن الزكاة لأنه يعذب، ولكن إذا كان يعني لا يجحد الزكاة وغير ذلك، ولكن يعني لا يدفع الزكاة تكاسلا أو يعني ما إلى آخر من أسباب، لأنه يعذب وبعد ذلك يدخل الجنة. فقالت أن يعني في خلال خلافة أبي بكر رضي الله عنه، بعد أن مات النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام، بعض الناس أبوا أن يدفعوا الزكاة، فقاتلهم أبو بكر رضي الله عنه. فهل هؤلاء الذين رفضوا أن يدفعوا الزكاة كانوا كفارا؟ هل قالوها؟ إن شاء الله أشكرهم. يعطيني لحظة واحدة أقرأ على الإخوة السؤال باللغة الإنجليزية، لأنه أرسل إلي باللغة الإنجليزية. There's a question that was sent by Sister Mujahid and was sent to me through the private earlier, so I'll just bring it up. And this question is, you mentioned that when a person does not pay zakat, he will be punished on the Day of Judgment. He's not sure zakat for unless he says that he does not believe in paying zakat. During the Khilafah of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, after passing away of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, some people refused to pay zakat, and Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu fought them. Were those people who refused to pay zakat kafir? تفضل شكرهم إن شاء الله. The Shaykh responded that we usually take the questions that are pertaining directly to jihad first, and then we take general questions. So, inshallah, he will be answering this question, although we take first the questions about jihad that are directly pertaining to jihad. First off, we mentioned, or one of the brothers asked about the last hadith that we mentioned, and he did not, get it, or he did not understand part of it. So the Shaykh quickly told him the story that when they were returning back from a journey, the Prophet ﷺ saw Jabir camels stopping, so he came up to him and found out that the camel is exhausted, so he hit it once with his lash with the blessings of the Prophet ﷺ. It started moving on with a fast pace, and the Prophet ﷺ asked Jabir if he would sell his camel to him. He said, sure, when you reach Medina, went to Medina by the must, and he tied his camel to the pavement, on the pavement at the mosque's gate. And the Prophet ﷺ came out, chatted the camel, Jabir said, here is your camel. He got his money, and later on the Prophet ﷺ sent him the camel back saying, the price and the camel are yours. And this was a nice gesture of the Prophet ﷺ. And there is any specific incident or a specific part of this hadith that you may not, you still have a problem understanding it, may point that out, and inshallah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we will explain it. The brother asked a question that was asked several times before, and his question is, pertaining jihad, would travel to Iraq, to fight for jihad, permissible? Shall we leave work and family and children to fight? Even though, is that permissible or is obligatory? Shall we leave work and family and children to fight, even though he never, or that person never got trained, or we will not go until there is a specific organization that fight against the creators, until pretty much he's trying to say that until there are a clear image or a clear picture of what's going on in Iraq, as far as
the organizations and the groups that we fight back. And then under which flag, are you under the cause of Allah or other causes? That's what he's trying to, you know, to get at. That Sheikh Barakallahu Fihi answered this question saying that we have touched upon this topic a few times before in other lessons, although we'll go on this matter quickly. First off, that you shall not leave for jihad and you leave at your homeland responsibilities that are not taken care of. So you shall not leave until those responsibilities are fully taken care of. Secondly, you should not leave until there is a cure and there is a secure way and a secure manner that you'll be able to reach that place. Otherwise, it will be impossible for you because you're not sure. Are you going to reach there or not? So if you say, oh, I'm just going to leave my responsibilities and go, what if you don't even reach that point? Then you gain nothing. First off, you're not taking care of your responsibilities, and you didn't go for jihad either. So first, take care of your responsibilities, so in case any risk that happened, then everything is taken care of. Secondly, when you're going, you find the best way that will make you reach there safely, and you can actually be able to make jihad and fight with the mujahideen, then you should go for it. And also, you shall not forget, you should have some sort of training. Some brothers actually travel and go with jihad with no training. And the brothers who are actually fighting, they wind up defending those who came from other countries to fight with no training. You know what I'm trying to say? They come and want to fight, but they don't know how to. Those there have no time to train. They're already in a tough situation. They're fighting. They don't have the time. They don't have the money. They don't have the energy. So you don't want to be a more responsibility on that. So you go there at least a little bit trained. You know what's going on. And also, we can't say that it's obligatory in every person to Umrah right now. The picture is not clear. We don't know what organizations are fighting over there quite yet. But although we say that there are some groups are fighting Iraq against the Crusaders, it is known. But maybe also people of Iraq by themselves, they may not need outside help. All these things are not quite known for us yet. Although, in conclusion, we say that whoever goes out for jihad with a good intention for the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he dies upon that, he's a shaheed, and it's a good cause, it's a good action. And jihad are one of the highest good deeds that one would ever make in his life, and it's a courageous deed. So you would go for it if you have those conditions all set and went through, then you can go ahead and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he help you and assist you in whatever you do for fighting for the cause of Allah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. I'm getting back to the question that was pertaining zakah and the hadith that we mentioned that one person does not pay zakah, he will be punished on the day of judgment, or he may go to hell or he go to paradise. He's not considered a kafir. And the one who does not pay zakah, unless he says that he does not believe in paying zakah. The sister added, during the khilafah of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, after the passing away of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, some people refused to pay zakah, and Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu fought them. Were those people who had refused to pay zakah kafir? We say, answering to this, that in the hadith that we have mentioned, that person who has not paid zakah did not pay zakat for a desire. It's not for saying, oh, I don't believe zakat is a part of the religion. No. He says, deep inside, he knows, I'm committing a sin. But I just couldn't find my desire. I like money, I couldn't find my desire. So this is the case. He may go to paradise, he may go to hell, and then get back to paradise. This is the case is left with Allah Ta'ala. He judges him. But with what happened in the incident that the sister mentioned, that those as the Prophet died said, oh, zakat is not in the religion. You know, zakat is not in the religion. We don't need it. Or it's not a part, we don't believe in it. It's a part of Islam anymore. As the Prophet died, it's gone. Done. Over with. Therefore,
Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu fought them.
Then what if a community, locality came out and said, we all might get fi zakah. In this situation, they get fought. Why?
Because it's a big gathering. It's a huge number of people all agreeing with something.
So this, the ruling, this becomes as if it's equal the one who says it's not a part of the religion. Why?
Because it's not a specific or an incident when it happens, you know, a community find three does not pay zakah, and another community find one who, no.
If the whole community agrees on not paying zakah,
then, oh, this is a problem. This has to be solved. This is not right. This is as if you're saying, you all of you says, oh, we're not paying zakah, zakah is not a religion.
But if it's a specific or a one or two incidents that happens that are turned around because of a person's desire, then it's a sin. It's a sin that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forget him for it, and he may not.
This is left for the judgment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
But the other that we have said, either a locality or a community just overcome that, or person himself says, oh, zakah is not from the religion. And that's either or, we're not a part, or we're not meant, or we're not the meaning of the hadith that we have talked about. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows better.